Heart with FM and Josh Baldwin there with Made for More. And today I can declare that you've been made for more. Whatever you are achieving in life right now, whatever you are doing, God has created you for a divine and a special purpose and destiny. And I believe that today's message here from Heartbeat FM will assist you to get to that divine purpose. When you go to Rome today, you will see that one of the apostles are celebrated there. His name was Simon Peter, a fisherman that followed Jesus around. And you might have read about Peter many times in the Gospels. You might have read about his life and the way he lived and the way he acted. Certain things are very memorable, like when Peter stepped out of the boat and he walked on water. But more memorable is when he sank. You know, Peter was made for something significant. He had a divine call upon his life. But certain preparation had to take place. When I read about the Mount of Transfiguration and Peter was there and Elijah and Moses appeared, Peter said, let's build tents and let's stay here, let's tabernacle here. Jesus didn't even answer him. And many times we read about Peter in the Bible. I want to talk to you a bit about human concerns, because this is the one thing that robs us of divine destiny. This is the one thing that steals our purpose. I'm saying you were made for more, but the human concerns, the things of this world, will come and it will squeeze the life out of God's word that's been placed inside of you. And this morning, to talk about human concerns, I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 16. And we want to read a bit and just unpack the scripture as we read. In verse 13, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? Now, we all have to answer that question. And even Christians will answer it differently. Some Christians will say, he is the center of my life. He is my all in all. He is my everything. Other Christians will say, he is somebody that I visit every Sunday in church. Other Christians will say, he is somebody that I visit every year, once a year, Christmas or Easter in church. But Jesus is asking his disciples, and they reply in verse 14. Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Jesus reiterates his question in verse 15. But what do you say? Who do you say I am? And today God is asking you that same question. He's asking you, what is Christ in your life? We are talking about human concerns. We are talking about stepping into divine destiny. We are talking about following this life of Peter, looking at the different mindsets that he had, looking at the different influences that worked upon his life. And it's the same for us. But before we get into that, we have to answer that question today. And we have to be honest, those online, those listening to Heartbeat FM 103.9, 107.4, all of us, we have to be honest and say, this is who Jesus is in my life. For many of us, we've become distracted. For many of us, we've become infected. Others have become entangled by sin and by the things of this world. But Simon Peter answers in verse 16, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of John, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. Jesus says that this revelation came from heaven. Peter received this revelation here at Philippi, Caesarea. In verse 18, he gives him a picture of his ministry. This is what I saw in Rome. When I saw the pictures of Simon Peter, when I saw the portraits of Simon Peter, when I saw the statues of Simon Peter all across the city of Rome, when I walked into St. Peter's Basilica, this huge, huge church built on the Apostle Peter's grave. Peter came to rest. His bones are under the high altar of this great, magnificent building. This isn't what Jesus meant, but this is just the magnitude of this man's effect on generations of 2,000 years of church history. We see Simon Peter. Jesus said, "I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it." So here Peter hears from heaven. He's influenced by heaven, and Jesus says, "Listen, this is the revelation that's going to take you into your divine destiny." Through church history, we've seen the effects of Peter's ministry. All across Rome, you can see it. All across the cities of the world, you can see it. You can come to North Africa. You can go to Western Europe. You can go to Eastern Europe. You can go to China. You can go to Japan. You can go everywhere. And somewhere you will see the influence of this man's ministry. And it's this revelation of who Jesus Christ really is that brings Peter to this point of receiving this almost prophetic word, that this is what you're going to achieve. Now, let me tell you today, if Christ is not everything in your life, Christ is not anything in your life. Listen clearly. If Christ is not everything in your life, Christ is not anything in your life. This means that the significance of your life on earth, your divine destiny, is linked to the preeminence of Christ in your life. He has to be the center. But Peter didn't understand the path to this. He didn't understand the path. And we see this in the unfolding events as we continue to read in the book of Matthew. In verse 21, in the same chapter, it says that from that time Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, that he must suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed on the third day and raised to life again. Jesus explains this to them. He says, "Listen, my divine call has not been comfort. It's not to restore a physical kingdom, but there's certain things that I have to come to. There's a certain divine destiny that awaits me." And when we look at the cross, which Jesus is talking about here, when we look at it from a human perspective, from human concerns, his mother, his disciples, his family members, if we look at it from human concern, it's a negative event. It's the death of Jesus, the end of his life. But if we understand it from heavenly perspective, it is the greatest event in human history since creation, and it will remain the greatest event for eternity, because it's the only event that took place that secured eternal life for humanity. It's the only event that opened the door for us to enter in. So this is the greatest event, and Jesus is telling them, from a godly perspective, this is what's going to happen to me exactly. He says, "I'm going to Jerusalem. There, the hands of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law are going to grab me. They're going to kill me, or at least arrange my death. And then I'm going to be raised from the dead again." This is what it actually meant to be the Messiah. The revelation that Peter had in verse 13, Jesus explained in verse 21. He says, "This is what it means in my life to be the Messiah. I have to go to the cross." You cannot look at the cross from a human perspective as negativity and saying, "Oh, Jesus has died. It's the end of his ministry. Oh, Jesus has died. It's a sad thing." No, Jesus paid the price, the ultimate sacrifice for the salvation of all, for all time. The greatest event looks like the worst event when we change perspectives. And this is what I want to challenge you with. Where are you standing? Are you watching your life and living your life from a humanistic viewpoint, where your comfort is your priority, where what you want is your priority? Or are you Christ-centered and your gaze set on heaven, and where you say, "Thy will be done, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven"? You see, even in the church today, there's this move. There's this move to self-fulfillment, to self-actualization, to fulfilling our desires, to wanting what we want. There are many times when God blesses us. There's many times when we receive that blessing, when we live in that blessing. But the reality is that our effectivity is found in our cross. Because we have to go to our cross before we can get to our resurrection. But many of us think that the gospel is a ticket to lustrous living and a wonderful, blessed life. And it is a blessed life. But it is a blessed life as we take up our cross every day and we follow Him. There's a slight paradox here because it sounds like you're saying two things, but you're not saying two things. You're saying that the worst thing that can happen to you is still the best thing that can happen to you, looking at it from a heavenly perspective. And let me put it this way, that whatever is inside of you, really inside of you, listen, this is deep, whatever is really inside of you will manifest in your darkest times, in your most difficult times. Whatever is inside of you, really inside of you, not your pretentiousness, not the face you put out there, not your social media profile and those things. No, I'm talking about what's really at the core of your human being. And sometimes God allows the delay of prayers. They're not answered. Sometimes the opposite happens to what we pray for. And what manifests at that moment is what's really inside of us. And Peter had to see this. He had to see what was really inside of him. Because here in Matthew chapter 16, he has this great revelation that Jesus is the Messiah. And Jesus says, listen, upon this revelation, I'm going to build my church. You're going to be effective. But then in verse 21, Jesus says, I'm going to die. I'm going to look weak. I'm not weak, but I'm meek. Power under control. I'm going to allow them to kill me because I want to step into this divine destiny. For this reason, I've come. So what does Peter do in verse 22? He took him aside and he began to rebuke him. And he said, never, Lord, this shall not happen to you. I will not allow it. And Jesus says to him, and this is sort of the title of this message this morning. In verse 23 of Matthew chapter 16, Jesus turns to him and says, Satan, get behind me. You are a stumbling block to me. And then he says, you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Earlier on, when Peter said, you are the Messiah, he had in mind the concerns of God. He had at the center the purpose and the destiny of God for his life. That purpose, that destiny in Christ's life led to the cross. But this was a challenge for Peter because Peter now turned to this position where he became controlled by demonic influences, by the devil himself, because of the fact that he had human concerns on his mind. Now, this is a challenge for you and for me, because what are we concerned about when we wake up in the morning? What are we thinking about, meditating about? What are we investing our time and our life in? What are we spending our life on? Look at your life as sand running out. And every time you close your eyes, you go to bed at night, a certain amount of sand has been spent. And if your life is illustrated on a line, it's become shorter. You've spent some that you cannot spend again. Tomorrow, as you walking, you're spending more and more and more until you spent it all and you end up facing God. What are you concerned about? Is this human concerns or is it godly concern? In verse 24, Jesus goes on to explain this. He goes on to explain something that the church today needs to hear and understand. Something that's not often preached because of the fact that it's not very popular. But we know that we are warned that in the last days, they will gather for themselves teachers who will soothe them in their hearing. And this is very possible today with everything available online. You can find any type of message that you are looking for, but it's not necessarily the message that you need. You can find any message. You can find a very feel-good message, but this message today might not be a feel-good message. It might be a message at looking at this cross and facing what Jesus has to go through and facing what you and I sometimes face. But then turning our perspective where we don't look at it from human concern, but we look at it from heavenly concern. What is the divine destiny? Jesus carries on in verse 24. He said to them, "Whosoever wants to be my disciple," in other words, whoever wants to follow me must deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. They must deny themselves. This is in the Bible. This is in Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. You and I need to deny ourselves. Difficult to hear, but true. You need to deny yourself and you need to take up your cross. Now, what does this refer to? Taking up your cross. It doesn't refer to adopting a mentality of suffering or honoring the devil. No, we stand against the devil. We fight this warfare. I'm not preaching a heresy message today, but I'm saying that there are things that we have to carry. We have to identify what the cross is in our lives. It doesn't always mean the same for everybody, but it's the type of suffering that's inflicted by the world that we live in, and sometimes even where demonic forces are attacking us. But it's not a purposeless suffering. It's not a suffering that's purposeless. I mean, it's not just having a suffering mentality and crawling through grass like they used to do in the Middle Ages, jumping into thorn bushes and just hurting yourself. No, that's you're missing the point. It's a cross. It's not a torture chamber. It's not talking about human torture or, adopting a suffering mentality. No, we have a mentality of sonship. We have a mentality of authority. We have a mentality of power, but we can still be cross-centered in our lives, which means we embrace our divine destiny above our personal and earthly desires, and we are willing to go to the cross. Jesus demonstrates this in Matthew 21, verse 9. We're carrying on in the book of Matthew. When he enters into Jerusalem, it says the multitudes cried out, "Hosanna to the Son of David." He had it made. Peter was probably rejoicing and very confused about what Jesus said about him having to die, because yeah, it looked like they were going to make Jesus king. Everything looked great. So what does Jesus do after that? After that glorious occasion in Matthew 21, verse 9, in verse 12, he makes a whip, he goes into the temple and he overturns the tables. And he calls them a den of robbers. Not a very good move if you're trying to take control of a country, or you want to be the next political seat, or you want to be elected by popular opinion. Not a very popular thing to do, to go into the temple at a festival and go and overturn the tables, make a whip and chase everybody around with a whip, and call them a den of robbers. You see what I'm saying? Peter might have looked at this and he might have said, "Oh, they were singing Hosanna to the king. You should have kept it there. Why did you do this? This is going to have a bad influence on your destiny." No, this is going to move you towards your destiny. Because it's this very thing, I believe, that was one of the catalysts in terms of Jesus' crucifixion a short while later. Peter might have thought, "Let's avoid the cross at all costs." Jesus said, "I'm going to the cross at all costs." The Bible says that resolutely he turned his face towards Jerusalem. He went to the cross willing. Jesus says here, back in Matthew 16, 24, "Whosoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself. He must not live in human concern. He must deny himself. He must take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whosoever loses their life for me will find it." What good will it be for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for his soul? And then he says, for the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. This is a mouthful. Jesus says, I'm going to my cross. Verse 22, Peter says, no, never. Jesus rebukes the satanic force behind Peter's rebuke. And then he says, you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Then Jesus says, listen, whoever of you wants to be my disciple, there's one requirement here. You have to deny yourself. You have to lay your life down like I'm doing now. You're going to do the same, just in a different way. Now, as I'm ending off this message, I want to ask you this question. What is driving your life every day? What are you actively pursuing every day? Are we talking about human concern in your life? Have you decided to spend your entire life wasting it? I'm telling you, wasting it. It says in verse 27 that the Son of Man will come in his glory with the angels, and he's coming to reward each person according to what they've done. So he says all of us will be judged for what we do. We have to follow Jesus as the author and the perfecter of our faith. We have to keep our eyes on him and follow him. And as the discomfort of the cross approaches us in our lives, we have to bear this by denying ourselves and by really willfully taking up that cross. And again, I'm saying to you, be theologically sound about this. Don't see a disease as a cross. Don't see constant, poverty or addiction as a cross. No, those things are demonic attacks, many of them. Yes, you might have seasons of standing in faith. That could be a cross. But you are always trusting God, and you always know that He will supply all your needs according to His riches and glory. So you understand that. You don't look at the cross, as this negative torture chamber. No, you look at this cross as this door to divine destiny, something that opens your divine purpose. And I want to end off with this. We know what happened afterwards. Jesus said, one of you will betray me. And Peter said, even if I have to die, I will not do it. And we know that he did it. He denied him three times. We know how Jesus restored him at the lake with a miraculous catch of fish, asking him, Simon, do you love me more than these? We look back at this life of Simon Peter and we see this history of going to his own cross. And if you read in the historical account, you will read this about Simon Peter and the end of his life. You will read that Simon was warned whilst in Rome that the officials were planning to execute him. And in the historical account, we read that Simon left Rome, and as he was walking across the bridge on his way to safety, Jesus came walking from the front. And he asked Jesus, where are you going? And Jesus said to him, I'm going to be crucified again. And it says in the historical account that at these words, Simon Peter turned around, perceiving that he had to lay his life down at that stage for the kingdom. He went back. And it says that the Roman officials grabbed him, and they were on their way to crucify him, and he asked them, can I ask you one thing? Crucify me upside down, because I'm not worthy to be crucified as Christ was crucified. And in the historical account, we read that Simon Peter, this man who had all these ideas and had all these things that he wanted to do and ways that he wanted to do them. And at the end of his life, he finally got to that place where he was willing to lay his life down. What he confessed at the table, at the Last Supper, he actually did that. He was willing to do that. We grow towards our divine destiny. We grow towards that point where we are willing to lay it down. Every single day that we live should take us closer, closer to absolute surrender. Are you willing? Says Simon was crucified upside down and then laid his life down. Are you willing today to lay your life down? As the Lord is saying that every Christian that suffers, our high priest knows that we are suffering. He said, Simon, I'm about to go and be crucified again in your life. Because whatever they do to you, they do to me. What will you say when Jesus walks past you and you are trying to escape your divine destiny? You are trying to run from what you're supposed to do. You're not denying yourself and taking up your cross. What are you going to do? Are you going to continue to run away from your cross and your divine destiny? Or are you going to be willing to turn around? And it is my prayer as I'm ending off this message that everybody that's listening, everybody that's watching, will make this commitment, not to me, not to the church, not to your pastor, but will make this commitment to Jesus Christ, that they will lay their lives down, that they will turn back into the city of Rome and willfully allow them to tie them to a cross, to put the nails through the hands and the feet, and to willfully lay their lives down. This is a gift from God that we can only do as we walk into total and absolute surrender. As we walk into this valley where we decide we are going to surrender everything to Him. And that's my prayer today, that you and I will walk into and remain in absolute surrender in Jesus' mighty name. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself. He must take up his cross and follow me. In Jesus' name, amen.